All right. We are finishing up our discussion of, I'll use the fancy term, Paul's ecclesiology, his doctrine of the church. And at the center, how the Corinthians need to respond more positively to God is how they are functioning as a social unit. And there are all kinds of things that Corinthians gets known for, but what I've tried to do here is to move from, first of all, the solution to the problem. God is the solution to the problems at Corinth. But now, what form does the solution take? And it takes an ecclesial form. If God is, if people are getting right with God, then it affects the health of the church. And a lot of people want to get right with God, but they're not interested in their commitment to the body of Christ. They're interested in Christ, they think. But they're really not interested in being distracted by other people that go to that congregation. And it's a fallacy. You can't grow closer to God and be cool toward the church. I'm not saying you can't be a Christian, but I will say your Christian growth is going to be limited and you may end up on a scrap heap somewhere. Because God puts up with it for so long, and then he says, look, I've had enough. You go run your own program. I have a son who is Lord of the church, and the church is the body of Christ. And if you want to grow in grace and knowledge, you're going to grow in commitment to the church. Now, that may not be just the church down the street from you that you go to, because church is the body of Christ everywhere. And most people are most involved in their local congregations. But there are a lot of ministers, for example, that have multiple bodies of Christ that they minister to. And there's nothing wrong with that. Or, you may be, say, committed to this church, but you may have a grandchild or a child or a friend, and you may be committed to another church too. That may be another part of the country, but you may pray for that church, or maybe, you know, you have means and you give for the sake of that church. Or what about Brother Wagner, who's in prison ministry. I'm involved in that church up north of Chicago. They've been in prison ministry for over 20 years. And what church are you helping in prison ministry? Because these men and women are in prison. And it's not like there's a church in the prison, although there are chaplains and there are bodies of believers. And they come from different denominations. And when they get out, then presumably they'll go to different kinds of churches. So how is that the church? Well, you know, there is the universal body of believers. And to say you got to be committed to the church, that doesn't necessarily limit you to, you know, the church bulletin at this or any other church. And well, what are the times that I can show my unity with the body of Christ? Certainly that can be important, but it can also be much broader than that. But let's look at some of these questions. Why can it be hard to feel part of a congregation? And how does Paul's teaching on the importance of all members of the body contribute to a sense of belonging? I'll answer it just to start out. It can be hard to feel part of a congregation because in some congregations they don't care about you. They care about themselves. And Paul's teaching convicts us if we're in a congregation that's self-centered. Some other answer. Why can it be hard to feel part of a congregation?
I think it's because we are self-centered. One of the issues that he talks about with communion, he says wait. Because people come in and they weren't waiting on the ones that were poor or late. And we have take a superiority position, it's hard to be a part of the church because what have we got to put up? I hear preachers, you know, I get so tired of this congregation lagging behind. So it's hard to be a part of that. And yet, that's very much a part of what he says to us to do.
Yeah.
And that whole business of love is totally about that. You know, not just loving Christ, but loving other people. And it means we've got to put up with some things.
Okay.
I would say also there's individuals that are self-centered, and when they come into the church, they're too into yourself to really open themselves up to opportunities that are there.
Okay. Good.
And people sit in the same seats every Sunday.
They own that place.
If you move around, I'm not going to find you.
And does anybody have, I mean, some of the ways that Paul's teaching contributes to a sense of belonging, but can anybody speak to that? How does Paul's teaching contribute to a sense of belonging?
What you were saying earlier is we have gifts, and we need all of those kind of things in the church that make it function. And like an orchestra or a ball team or something, there's people that do things that they're not the stars, but they're very, you can't do it. Can't play the music or play the game without them.
Mm-hmm.
They have to be there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that would be an answer. Why can it be hard to feel part of a congregation? Maybe a congregation is just limping along at 15-20% of capacity because people aren't engaging. Mm-hmm. And there's not a lot there to be part of except, you know, ritual activity from a certain time to a certain time, then everybody splits up and goes back to life. You know, their life. Number two is easy answers. To whom do members of the body belong? You could answer it several ways, but how would you answer that?
Christ, number one.
Christ, he's the head of the church. We belong to Christ. We were bought with a price. Who else do we belong to? Each other.
Yeah.
See, that's a very important part. And it's not to say, no, you're wrong. It's not Christ. It's each other. It's to say, who does Christ, how is his body composed or comprised? What's it comprised of? If it's comprised of many, then we belong to each other as much as we belong to the head. And then, of course, Christ is the one sent from God. So we belong to God. Because he came to bring us to God. 1 Peter 3:18. Christ died once for sins in order to bring us to God. Now, we're not there yet. We're here on earth. God's in heaven. We're getting there. But along the way, we belong to God. And he's entrusted us into the hands of the body of his Son to that point. Galatians 6:2. Bear one another's burdens. Fits well with 1 Corinthians 12:26, which says, if one member suffers, all suffer together. If one member is honored, all rejoice together. But does Paul contradict himself with Galatians 6:5? Each will have to bear his own load. So how do we keep those two things together? Bear one another's burdens. Each will have to bear his own load.
One possibility, each person has their own gift, and that gift is able to bear a particular type of load. You know what I mean?
Okay.
Like say in they're apropos for different
okay.
things.
What is proposed in 1 Corinthians 12 with this one body, it's not a can I call it a Christian socialism, where it's like a big pot of oatmeal and everybody's boiled down into an equality. Everything is uniform and the same, and we can't be much different, we can't be much higher, we can't be much lower on any scale. It's an egalitarian society, radically egalitarian. And what we learn throughout Scripture is the importance of a called a dialectic, a back and forth. You got to walk that lonesome valley. You got to walk it for yourself. Nobody else can walk it for you. You got to walk it by yourself. You've got to come to terms with God. Now, you come to terms with God, you find other people come to terms with God too. And so you're a member of the body of Christ. But in that unity, you never leave and lose your individuality. And that's part of what is so blessed about our unity. When things are going right, people affirm us in our uniqueness, our personality, our privacy, if I can use that word. I mean, even in a marriage where things can and should be so open, the other person is still another person. And actually, they're a mystery. Especially if you're a husband. You're married to a mystery. And one of the biggest mysteries is, why does this woman continue to be committed to me? When over so many years, we've seen again and again that she doesn't really get why I do certain things I do or why I am certain ways. I've had a big breakthrough in my marriage. But it took about 20 years, but my wife finally started eating ketchup on her scrambled eggs. You know, for about 20 years, I think that was a great offense. But, you know, my grandfather taught me, and I couldn't quit. But there are those things that now, after 44 years, still she just doesn't get. And some of them have to do with ketchup. And yet she loves me. And so we do, and this, you know, at Corinth they were dropping the ball on both ends. They were dropping it as a unity, but they were also dropping it individually. And as individuals, there are things, and you mentioned the use of our gifts. That's a positive take on this, and that's good. But what about our sins? What about our sins? Sin was a problem at Corinth. And the unity of the church, as high and glorious as it may be, that doesn't in the end compensate if I'm sneaking around and I'm living in sin and rebellion against God. The church isn't there to assist us in sin management. Now, again, we all sin. We're all being sanctified. And when we do stumble, that's what 1 Corinthians 6:2 is about. Restore a person. If anybody's caught in a trespass, it's going to happen. But you are responsible to God to be getting your act cleaned up. You know, and sanctification is progress, so we're always cleaning up our acts. But you know what I'm saying? There are people, and maybe it has been you or me at times in our lives, where we fall into grievous sin. And that can kill a church. That's another reason sometimes congregations don't feel very welcoming, because there's a lot of sin in the congregation. I mentioned my wife, and I'll just mention again, you know, one of the gifts my wife has, and actually a lot of women have this gift, is that they can sense an immoral man. And I was married to my wife for a long time before I understood how she defined the word creep. Or she would say, that guy gives me the creeps. And I just thought, well, you know, I don't, what does that mean? It means he had an eye for women. And I didn't see it, but my wife did. And we've gone into churches, and ministers have eyes for women. That doesn't make a woman feel welcome in that congregation if she's being sized up. by a man, whoever the man is. And it's the Holy Spirit. And when the Holy Spirit is in the body of Christ, there's a sanctity there, and there's a respect there, and there's a purity there. And when people embrace each other, there's not something off color going on. You know, it is a brotherly and a sister embrace, and that is a gift of the Spirit. Because without the Spirit, there is going to be something a little off going on, you know, just given most people. Men and women, that embrace means something sexually. But in Christ and in the Holy Spirit, that can sort of be backgrounded, and it's not a factor anymore, because we're relating on a different level now. We have the sanctity of our marriages, you know, Hebrews 13, let the marriage bed be undefiled, but greet one another with a holy kiss. And that's possible. That's possible when we realize that one of our burdens, so to speak, is to be right with God and to be cleansed by God and to be living in Christ so that we can live pure lives. And if you have a lot of impurity in a church, it's a good thing people don't feel at home there. If they do, they're just going to add to the problem that's there. What are some steps in moving from feeling like a deserted island in the midst of a congregation, or like a permanent visitor, this is on page 5, to arriving at a sense of belonging? How may the exercise of our gifts affect your sense, it should say, of organic connectedness to your church? What are mistakes congregations need to avoid if they want to minimize estrangement of those on the fringe and maximize their sense of full inclusion in the body? Anybody want to, you know, speak to any of those questions? We're going to go to about 11:20, and then we'll give you 10 minutes extra for lunch. So a step in moving from feeling like a deserted island would be to be a member of a Sunday school class. Okay?
That's an issue that I haven't figured out for sure. In a larger church, how to make, without the smaller group experience, how to get people to do more than be basically observers. Because when you get, it seems to me like a church, experience, when they get to be about a couple hundred people, when you get larger than that, you can do a lot of things that you couldn't do before, but it's, you start losing opportunities for people to be involved. And if there's a way to do that bigger, I don't know how to do it.
That's why
that's one of the problems with mega churches today. Yeah. People can just drift here and there because they really never get a place that they feel an ownership. They go to a church, but it's not their church. They'll say, I go to such and such a church. They don't call it their church.
And that's why some church staff positions, they have what they call a pastor of assimilation. You know, because you can get people to come, especially if you're a great preacher. I mean, people will come. But how do you get them to move beyond the spectator level? Especially because a lot of people are resistant to that. They like to feel the benefit of public worship, especially if it's good public worship, good music, interesting message. You know, you've done your God thing and then go home.
But when do they get to use their gift?
Well, that's the next question. How may the exercise of our gifts affect our sense of connectedness? And if we don't contribute, we're going to feel distant. And so the question is, how do we encourage people to contribute?
You ask.
Well, I just, you know, basically prayer and the movement of the Spirit, because we don't have an answer to some of this stuff. We can't move people that are immovable.
You talking about people who want to belong, though. Most of us will go to something if you're asked. So
yeah.
Really, it's a matter of You say, fellow comes in, haven't seen him for a while. Hey, we got a men's meeting coming up. You want to go? So a lot of it is about going out, even though you're still at your church, still a place that everybody comes to. It's like going out to get a draw men. I remember reading something about this in a conference session about salt, where you just kind of make little stories up, little tidbits, get their curiosity up, and draw them into the fold of things, so that they feel like, yeah, they can be a part of it. But if nobody invites them, a lot of people will just continue to back away instead of reaching out to do something. There's probably more extroverts and introverts.
Not so much here, but I've been in other places where somebody may actually try to offer to use a gift that they have, and either be causing a click type thing, or maybe just not paying attention to it. I know we got enough people. They in essence tell that person no without even realizing they're telling that person no, and after one or two no's, they say, "All right, forget about it." So we may subconsciously, without trying to keep ourselves open, actually be pushing people away.
Okay. Well, we're not going to arrive at definitive answers to these questions, but I think they are questions that a study of the doctrine of the church in 1 Corinthians suggests to us. And I do think that there are answers. There are answers, at least resources for answers to these questions in Paul's teaching on the church and the consciousness, especially of there are people in the church, in any church, there are a critical mass of people that set the tone. If you're waiting for uniformity in a church, forget it. It's never going to come. But what you want is for the critical mass to be on the same page. And if the critical mass of people in a church want there to be a hospitable aura, people come to church. Not everybody they meet is going to greet them, but it's going to be hard to come to that church for very long without realizing there's a place for me here. Do I want to be in this place? Is God calling me here? That's another question. But I've been in unhospitable churches, and I've been in very hospitable churches, and it doesn't take a lot of people to make the difference. And Paul just reminds us here of the importance of the body dynamic. And if you read the whole of 1 Corinthians, you get a sense for here are some ways that we can lower the sense of Christ and the Spirit in this body dynamic, and here are some ways that we can enhance that. So, to summarize 1 Corinthians, the letter contains outstanding, this is number 10, outstanding chapters on the nature and function of the church, especially chapter 12, which we've only done half of, a great chapter on love, and a great chapter on Christ's resurrection. The only mention of the Lord's Supper in Paul's letters is found in chapter 11 in 1 Corinthians. It's amazing, because we rightly assume it was practiced all throughout the early church, but the only time Paul mentions it is in one place. And a lot of times you'll read scholars saying, well, Paul couldn't have written this because he doesn't mention this. And that's usually specious reasoning. The frequency of mention of matters in Paul's letters is often very random. Paul cites Jesus' words and gives instructions on partaking in a worthy manner. So the words of institutions that you typically hear a pastor give from communion often are 1 Corinthians 11. And in all these issues, God's love, the church, blah, blah, there are life-changing implications for believers in Christ. So 1 Corinthians is not an academic presentation of anything. It's all practical, theological. It illustrates how problem-stricken a church can be. It's got factions. It's got spiritual immaturity. There's flagrant immorality. And members are suing each other in the civil courts. It's pretty extreme. Conditions like this are incompatible with Christ's lordship. Paul writes to correct these sins and abuses, but he places the gospel at the center and not human problems or solutions. And there's data taking us back to God. Among resources to heal the dysfunctions are the cross. The letter calls readers back to the bedrock of Christ crucified. This also takes us kind of back to here. Each will have to bear his own load. Often, in fact, I will say inevitably, corporate renewal is the result of a composite of individual renewals. You just can't legislate renewal from the top down. It's going to grip people from the bottom up too. And it might just be a wife here and some kids there and two or three men over here. It can be very random how a church moves from, you know, maybe a state of lethargy to a state of, more engagement with the gospel. But people rediscover the cross and the work of the cross. I've been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. Secondly, God's truth, which Paul writes about in chapter 2. In every generation, there are reigning schools of human thought. During the break, Jim and I were talking about Hellenism, whether you're talking, and of course Hellenism was the air that people breathed in the Greco-Roman world, and how man-centered Hellenism was. That's why classical statuary features the nude, because it exalts man. And in practical terms, there's no God. And our world today, our Western thought, it's thoroughly Hellenistic. Thoroughly, to the core, man is all there is. That's how we can kill so many babies every day worldwide. 19,000 in China, 11,000 in India, 4,000 in the United States every day. Over a billion now since the 1920s. Over a billion babies have been killed with the help of technology. Why do we do that? Because we have no fear of God. Even human life, there's nothing sacred about it. If we are more powerful than a baby in the womb, and if we want to take the baby's life, what can it do? We just say it doesn't exist. But of course, it does exist. God's truth triumphs human thought. That's a big reminder of 1 Corinthians. God's judgment, those who promote godless divisions in the church had better be careful. If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy him. Let no one boast in men. God saved the people out of Egypt, but their hearts remain hard. And that whole generation died in the wilderness. The people who ate the manna and drank the water that God provided. And what about this for sort of a closing benediction? If anyone has no love for the Lord, let him be accursed. That's pungent. Warnings regarding immorality and idolatry. And this is going to get worse and worse in the modern church because, dynamics are different around the country and so on and so forth. But in our country, more and more millennial age people have lived so long in immorality that they can't imagine a religion that would demand them to make a break with their sexual freedom. So sleeping around is routine. Often even among people who go to church. And it's also gotten over to the point that people can't imagine that God would deny same-sex expression to people. And there are powerful apologetics out there in the culture that say, well, you were born that way. Which is, the science is very sketchy on that, actually, but it's what people want to believe. And 1 Corinthians reminds us that God is also the God of our sex lives. And it's just more explicit in 1 Corinthians because there is that celebrated case that Paul uses as sort of an epitome of something that was wrong at Corinth. He's not saying it's wrong to have been involved in sexual immorality, but he's not saying you can have that in your past and you're never really going to be any different. No, he's saying there's freedom from that. In fact, you folks were involved in sexual immorality. Okay, great. We all have sins. And, you know, God saves us of our sins and cleanses us. But he uses the case of incest in the church to highlight the power of the gospel to change lives. And it's not, if it's not changing lives, then people haven't embraced the power of the gospel. That's a big lesson for 1 Corinthians for today. Resurrection, there are skeptics about the resurrection. I think today that it's not so much skepticism of it, it's apathy towards the relevance of it. Who cares? Who cares if the Bible says Jesus rose from the dead? Especially if I'm not a Christian. Why should I care? I'm ministering to a young couple right now, quasi-churched. It's for their wedding, premarital counseling. I'm trying to get them interested in God. And at one level, they go, yeah, in theory, but you know, so far I haven't seen the Holy Spirit move and really make them take it seriously. It's just out here like, oh yeah, well maybe we need to go to church. No. I'm not saying just go to church. I'm talking about you personally, your relationship with God. Well, Jesus died and rose for you. What? You know, they want the benefits of God for their marriage, but, you know, do they really care that Jesus came and died and rose? That's one of the points that Paul presses in this Greek culture where there are many, many gods. He's trying to say, look, the Son of God came, the God who made all people, the God who made the world, he sent his Son, he died, you heard the word of the cross, you responded, and now you're questioning that he rose from the dead? And I want to close with just a reference to a verse in 1 Corinthians that a lot of people never saw, but it's there. And, you know, I cite it with trepidation, but it's 1 Corinthians 15:34. Wake up from your drunken stupor, as is right, and do not go on sinning, for some have no knowledge of God. I say this to your shame. So, judge not lest you be judged. You know, we want to leave people's souls in God's hands, but we also don't want to be idealistic or unrealistic about what you find in a church. Billy Graham said years ago, the most fertile field for evangelism in North America is the church. Not that everybody doesn't need to hear the gospel, but most people don't respond to the gospel. But there are a lot of people in churches who need to hear the gospel, and they're on the church roll, but they don't know God. And that's another reason sometimes we don't feel welcome in a church, is because some of the people who are there don't know the Lord. And I'm not saying this so we'll be suspicious or antagonistic. I'm saying it so that we can continue to be forthright in testifying to the gospel in the church. You know, we need to keep the cross central. We need to continually encourage one another, just as Paul does in 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through following. He encourages the Corinthians by calling them back to what Christ did, his death and his burial and his resurrection, and how it was seen. That's why I brought these books on the Bible. It's true. It happened. And even in a so-called postmodern world, where, you know, they say in the universities, there are no facts, there's just interpretations and blah, blah, blah. I'll close with this and we'll go to lunch. I do children's sermons when I go up to the church near Chicago. And, you know, it's Chicagoland, very sophisticated area. And it's postmodern, we don't believe in truth anymore, and everything's relative. And so I've got 30 or 40 kids up in front of the church, and I read a Bible verse, as I always do, and then I explain the Bible verse, and then I illustrate the Bible verse. And I said, now I'm going to tell you a story. And right out in public, this little kid, you know, I don't know, 8-year-old, he stops me, he goes, "Wait a minute, is this a true story?" You know, 8-year-old kids know truth matters. And then they go to high school and university, and then they learn there's no such thing as truth. But, you know, we know better than that. Man knows better than that. And so we can tell people the truth, and they may have a defense mechanism of what they learn in college or what they hear in the media and so on and so forth, but don't believe it. We're made in God's image, and God has given us the capacity to recognize truth and error. And if we will spread the truth, there will be a certain percentage of people. God will snag them. The Holy Spirit will get them, and he'll bring them into the body of Christ. So bon appetit. See you in an hour and 5 minutes.